and its big claim to fame is it's highly salt tolerant. It's the most salt tolerant among all warm season turf grasses. We've had a breeding program on Seashore Paspalum since early 1990s, and that program has been very successful in developing a number of varieties, probably five or six different cultivars. Those cultivars have actually been licensed all over the world, Mexico, Australia, Middle East, Southeast Asia, China, etc., and are being grown and used primarily by the golf industry. And the reason the golf industry is interested in this grass is because many of the venues that they put golf courses on are salt affected. You know, coastal venues are beautiful places to build golf courses. Many of the golf courses are built on in tropical paradises, but the water quality is very poor, brackish, etc. So this grass has gained quite a bit of acceptance worldwide. It's a very international grass. Now, after 10 years of what we consider success with the grass, we're getting a lot of feedback on it. And one of the big feedbacks is this grass has got a problem because we can't control bermudagrass in it. So anybody else have a problem with bermudagrass control? It's kind of a hard weed to control. In fact, this gentleman right here was our weed scientist when we started working on Seashore Paspalum. He spent several years looking for a selective herbicide that would be able to kill bermudagrass and not damage Seashore Paspalum. Did you find anything, BJ? He didn't find anything. We've had two subsequent weed scientists since then work on the same issue. They haven't found anything either. So right now, a golf course superintendent's best option, really, is to spray it out with Roundup a couple of times, very high rates, cut it out with a side cutter, and then replace it. This problem is big enough that it's threatening the future of this species in the turf as a turf grass. If we don't do something to improve our ability to control bermudagrass in it, people are going to be less likely to adopt it, because in 5 years their golf courses are infested with bermudagrass that they can't control and they have to consider renovation. So we had to find a fix. Well, one of the big options could be to be like the row crop guys, right? We could develop a herbicide resistant system. Anybody know what that is? A few people do. How about Roundup Ready soybeans, Roundup Ready cotton, Roundup Ready corn, Roundup Ready sugar beets? Those are the most common examples of herbicide resistant systems. So to build resistance into a crop that's normally susceptible and then thereby allow control. Well, Roundup Ready Vent was developed more than 10 years ago by Scotts. It has still not been commercialized and is likely never to be commercialized. It's never gained approval. There are a lot of concerns about it. One is outcrossing, etc. And Seashore Paspalum, I don't think it's a good option because the grass is very, very international. And the cost of registering a GM product or GM trait in a turf grass is outrageous. So you got to have a really big market, and you got to have enough money to justify it. We don't have that with Seashore Paspalum. Another problem is that every country has its own regulations, and so you have to go through registration in every country you market. So the fact that we market this grass all over the world would be prohibitive to use a GM-related trait. So, next idea, a non-GM trait, right? What could that be? There are examples of non-GM herbicide-resistant systems out there. An example would be clearfield wheat, which is a natural mutation that confers resistance to imidazoline-known herbicides in wheat. And it's been deployed successfully and used for many years. We needed kind of an imi kind of wheat system for Seashore Paspalum. We look for herbicide class of chemistry that would allow us to control bermudagrass, or at least manage bermudagrass. The biggest candidate was a group of chemicals called ACCase inhibitors. These are grass herbicides. They're old chemistry. They've been around since the 70s. They've been broadly used to control grasses in a number of broadleaf crops such as soybean, sugar beet, canola, etc. around the world. So we got a class of chemistry that could help us to manage bermudagrass. But now we need resistance. Well, if you go back in the literature, when we started looking, we found that resistance had occurred to some of this class of chemistry in different countries around the world, different continents. Australia to ryegrass, South Africa to foxtail, Europe to blackgrass. So when the weed physiologists started trying to figure out what the mechanism or what the nature of that resistance was that had occurred in these grasses, these normal weeds that could be controlled and were no longer being controlled, they found a single mutation that was conferring a high level of resistance to these herbicides. And guess what? All over the world, different grasses, same mutation. So now we've got potential system. We've got a herbicide that controls it, will control bermudagrass or help us to manage bermudagrass, and we've got a known mutation that's occurring in other species. So all I had to do, or all we had to do, was devise a very efficient system to find that mutation in the grass that I wanted it in, which was seashore paspalum. So we're able to effectively screen for resistance to this herbicide by lacing the media with the herbicide itself. The result was that we found 63 resistant cell lines. Two of those lines regenerated into resistant plant material. We tested that material with dose response in the greenhouse on mature plants and found a 15-fold increase in herbicide resistance. So now we thought we had made it. This was 2009. We're still 5 years away. That was 5 years ago. Obviously, we had a few problems along the way. One of the problems was we had additional mutations from the material. The material wouldn't flower, so I couldn't breed with it. So the first test we put out was over here on those two tests on the right. That was 2012, 2013. And we tested this initial material with a very high level of cethoxidin resistance against other cethoxidin, as well as a couple of other herbicides in this class. And we learned quite a few things. One was the plant material that came out of tissue culture wasn't fit enough to be a commercial variety. Two was, with repeated applications and high rates, we could manage bermudagrass using this class of chemistry. We had a breakthrough last year. We used a technique called embryo rescue, where we crossed the mutant lines that had a high level of male sterility, and were able to get about six lines back out of this that had the herbicide resistance by back crossing it to a known variety. And we got rid of a lot of the extraneous mutations that were inhibiting growth and reducing flowering.